Hey, thank you. If you could just advance to the agenda slide, I think we are good to go.
Awesome.
So again, like Julie had said, thank you everyone for showing up today. Go ahead and go to the next slide, if you would, please. Let's talk a little bit about what we want to cover. We're excited you're here, and this is what we've got in store for you over the next 45 or 50 minutes or so. So after a couple of introductions, we'll spend a few minutes talking about some trends that'll impact risk adjustment in 2021 and beyond. And then we'll say a few words about how technology can help you overcome some of the challenges that you might face as you perform your HCC coding this year, kind of in the wake of the pandemic. And we'll spend a little bit of time showing you our HCC coding solution at work in the DrChrono EHR. Next. So I'm Derek Kren, VP of Business Development at Inferscience. That's me on the left. And then joining me today is Matt Owen, who is our DrChrono channel manager. I've been with Inferscience for about 2 years now and have been working in healthcare as both a provider and someone on the business end for well over 20 years. And way back in the day, I was an Air Force medical officer. So I've kind of seen healthcare grow and transform both as a provider and as someone who works in technology. Matt, do you wanna say a word about yourself?
Certainly. So my name is Matt Owen, and I serve as one of the channel managers here for Inferscience. I joined a little over 6 months ago, but I'm a 20-year veteran myself of the healthcare industry. Most of my time has been served in the sales and management areas, mostly of technology companies like McKesson and LexisNexis, and now Inferscience. So I'm really glad to have this opportunity to speak with this particular channel with DrChrono today.
Oh, great. Next, please. So before we kind of launch into HCC coding and our DrChrono solutions, I think it's important to just kind of point out how things have changed since the pandemic. I don't know about you, but my days pretty much consist of working from home, trying to accomplish all the work projects that I've set for myself or my wife has work set for myself, and then also settling in for an evening of Netflix. Before the pandemic, honestly, I didn't watch a whole lot of TV. Afterwards now, that seems like all we do in the evenings. And I think I plowed through all the really good stuff on Netflix, and now I'm scraping the bottom of the barrel. Unfortunately, it looks like it's gonna be like that for a while. So we might as well kind of get used to it. Next. So I think it goes without saying that, you know, the pandemic really changed healthcare's plans, changed your plans as a provider, and really did a number on the global healthcare delivery system. And the negative impacts that we're seeing go way beyond hand sanitizer shortages and toilet paper shortages, you know, at the grocery store. Before the pandemic, I think that personnel and the medical supply chain had largely kept up with demand. We didn't really see critical shortages in personnel areas or in the medical equipment. But afterwards, it's a completely different story. Not only were there shortages in things like ventilators, PPE, but all of that was really compounded by layoffs of physicians, mid-levels, nurses, as well as our medical personnel getting sick themselves. So that just kind of had a compounding effect. Preventive care was also really disrupted during the pandemic. Before the pandemic, you know, the emphasis on preventative care was and population health management was perhaps never greater than it was before the pandemic. I think that technology really helped with patient engagement, helped to bring people into the office and to do all of the preventive stuff we know keeps people well. Well, all that changed after the pandemic. Non-COVID ED visits are down 50%. Immunization rates are down 50 to 75%, really depending on the vaccination. And in speaking about preventative care, one of the more disturbing trends that I've seen is that urgent referrals for suspected cancer are down over 75%. So it doesn't take an epidemiologist to figure out that that really sets the stage for increases in cancer-related deaths due to a lack of early intervention. So it's like we flip-flopped. We went from this culture of trying to prevent chronic conditions and to prevent them from turning into, you know, more acute conditions, to simply fighting fires and dealing with, you know, these, you know, acute conditions, and the bulk of them COVID-related conditions. And telehealth kind of goes without saying that telehealth really kind of transformed how we deliver medicine. I was thinking about this today, and I think that, well, I don't think, but before the pandemic, I had never had a telehealth visit in all my years of, you know, being a patient as well as being a provider. Not once did I have a telehealth visit. I think that since the pandemic, I've maybe stepped foot into my PCP offices, provider's office once. That's it, just once. And I've had a few telehealth visits with them. So telehealth is here to stay, and I think we're all on board with that. Next. So let's go back to a previous bullet and talk about patient utilization. So if you're a provider that's treating Medicare Advantage patients, we're talking to you now. So how will utilization trends impact MA patients and your practice? I think a couple of ways. First, people are going to continue to defer elective care. I think that we need to try to get them either in front of you face-to-face in the office or, you know, by telehealth or phone as much as possible. But I think the fact remains people are going to put stuff off. So that's creating a bunch of pent-up demand during these quarantine periods. I think the quarantines were more strict early on in the pandemic. However, with this resurgence, you know, towns and countries and municipalities are revisiting quarantines, much to, you know, a lot of people's consternation. But this will initially reduce costs, but ultimately it's going to lead to a surge of claims later on this year and into 2022. And second of all, although CMS has changed the measurement year used to determine next year's star ratings, the fact remains that last year's documentation gaps, they're going to impact contract periods over the next 3 years. So the takeaway is that patient engagement is critical, as is closing gaps in care. And the way to do that is the visits. You know, if you're treating Medicare Advantage patients, you know that you've got to get them in to document conditions at least once every year, hopefully more, but thorough documentation right now is key. That will set you up to make sure that your MA funding levels will stay healthy next year and beyond. Next. So in speaking about Medicare Advantage, it's going to become more and more of a challenge. So you see that number 26.9 million in the circle on the right. That's the number of older Americans enrolled in Medicare Advantage right now. It's almost 27 million. And CMS projects that number is going to increase to almost 41 million by 2030. And believe it or not, 2030 is only 9 years away. So over the next decade, less than a decade, I expect that most all primary care practices in the US, regardless of size, it doesn't matter if it's one or two providers up to hundreds of providers, I think they're all going to enter into some kind of risk-based contracting with Medicare Advantage health plans. So, you know, be ready for that. The demand is just going to keep growing and growing for MA services. Next. So let's take a few minutes and just get back to the basics and talk about risk adjustment and HCC coding. And we'll talk about why Medicare risk adjustment and HCC coding are becoming more and more critical to succeeding as a primary care and internal medicine provider. So when we talk about risk adjustment in general, we're talking about the many different risk adjustment systems within the US healthcare system. And I hope you're free for the next couple of days because we're going to go over each and every one of them in excruciating detail. So settle in and no, I'm just kidding. We're only gonna focus on one of them. And that's the CMS HCC model. That's the most prevalent one. And it's the model that uses HCC codes to determine how you, the provider, gets paid. Now, HCC codes aren't the only thing that CMS uses to determine funding levels and expenditures, but it's a big piece of the pie. So risk adjustment, I have here, risk adjustment is the system. Well, it's a system. It's really a variety of methods that's used by the federal government and health plans to offset the cost of providing health insurance for individuals who represent a relatively high risk to insurers. So these are traditionally older, more complex patients. Now, CMS HCC, we've got all these abbreviations here and acronyms, but CMS HCC is the model. So HCC stands for hierarchical condition categories, and HCC coding is the payment model that was mandated by CMS way back in 97. So this really got its start in the late 90s. But it wasn't implemented until around 2003. So this is the model that identifies individuals with serious or chronic illnesses and assigns what's called a risk factor score to the person based on a few things. But the two main things that are taken into account when assigning RAF scores, risk adjustment factor scores, are the individual's health conditions, which you document using HCC codes, as well as a number of demographic details. So CMS throws all of that stuff into the mix and assigns a risk adjustment factor score that helps to determine expenditures and your funding. So HCC coding, our third bullet point, that's simply the method by which you as a healthcare provider document your patient's chronic conditions. There are over 80 HCC categories. I think the number is up to 82. I could be off by one or two, but it's over 80 now. So that's more than 9,000 ICD-10 codes that map to HCC categories in this particular model. So it's pretty complex stuff, but that's why we use technology to assist with it. Next slide, please. So this is a visual representation of how HCCs and RAFs work together. So the categories and the risk adjustment factor scores, this is how they work together. So there's an HCC category for diabetes. And if you only document diabetes, that will produce a lower RAF score or risk adjustment factor score. Now, if you take that same diabetes diagnosis and you add other chronic complications, then it becomes a medium score because you're docking more conditions. So you've got the diagnosis, anything that's kind of comorbid. But if you diagnose and document more acute complications, then that results in a high score. So you can kind of see the progression here. And this plays into the concept of what we call specificity or coding to specificity. Diabetes in general, and then as we progress up, we record more chronic and acute complications, which adds to the score and makes it higher. Now, if you take diabetes and you throw in a condition like CHF, then you'll really get the highest score possible. Now, you don't want to simply document for the sake of upping scores, but you want to do it for accuracy's sake. And then also accuracy in your HCC coding, not only does it have a significant impact on your funding as a provider, but then it also can have an impact on your patient care, and you can get better outcomes through more specific HCC coding. And that's because referrals to specialists really is kind of a big part of that. So HCC coding, again, it's just a real critical piece to how you get funded. Next slide. So how does it translate into real dollars, or how does that RAF score translate into real dollars? So remember when we talked about kind of just the basics, kind of that basic diagnosis of diabetes, that in and of itself, relative to a more specific code, doesn't have a whole lot of value. So the average RAF score in the US is about one, give or take some hundredths of a point. So let's take, for example, a male who's 75 to 79 years old. His assigned RAF score is 1.062. So this is someone who, with a RAF of just over one, should be not that difficult to treat. It's relatively simple, not a high level of complexity. And the annual funding or expenditure that you could expect to treat this individual is about $9,600 a year. But let's say there's a lot more going on, okay? And we need to document more specific complications, as well as capture everything that is going on with this patient. Well, codes have RAF scores assigned to them. They have a value. So this acute myocardial infarction might have a RAF score of 0.282. And then we've got COPD and renal failure. And those have RAF coefficients, as we like to call them, and they all add up. So through careful and accurate documentation and thorough documentation, the patient's RAF score could increase to nearly two. Now, what's the impact on funding? Well, to treat a relatively uncomplicated patient, you might get $9,600 a year, but to treat someone who's more complex, that could increase to, say, $17,000 a year. So it's not just for the sake of increasing funding, but it's to get compensated for treating patients who are more complex. Now, you're kind of doing yourself and the patient a disservice if you don't code completely into the highest level of specificity. Because you know, this can the funding can really have an impact on you know, your treatment for this patient. Next. So what are the challenges with regard to risk adjustment and HCC coding in kind of the wake of this pandemic? Actually, I guess we're not in the wake. It's still going on. We've kind of had some resurgences in infection rates. But anyhow, what are some of the challenges that you might face? So it's great that we've embraced telehealth, and I think that's fantastic. On the other hand, though, overall healthcare utilization, it's still down. So using telehealth services is up, but overall utilization down. And that means fewer opportunities to document HCC codes. And like we saw previously, the HCC coding is key. HCC coding is key to making sure that you're funded or compensated at a level that the government says you need to be compensated at. So I think that's just good for medicine overall. So there are fewer opportunities to document HCC codes. Now, that makes the annual wellness visits and that mandate that you see that patient at least once a year to document their health risks, makes that especially important. So even though healthcare utilization is down, walking into the PCP's office is down, it's vitally important to make sure that you see those patients at least once a year. And CMS has relaxed some of the rules around what can be coded and when. It used to be that phone visits and telehealth visits, you cannot code for HCCs, but that's not the case anymore. So even though thorough documentation is critical to improving patients' RAF scores, lots of staffing and budget cuts have increased the pressure on physicians and mid-levels to improve HCC coding accuracy. So that can be challenging because let's face it, as a physician, you probably didn't learn about HCC coding in med school. You know, you're focused on treating the patient. That's what you want to do. That's what you're passionate about. And HCC coding, even though it's becoming more and more relevant and imperative, is probably not something that you want to do or enjoy doing. And again, that's why technology is available to help take some of that pressure off of you and to help you be more accurate and efficient in your coding. So anyhow, all these challenges, really, once you combine them with expected decreases of 4 to 6% in Medicare Advantage patients, they're really forcing groups to kind of rethink their risk adjustment strategies. So again, more and more are leaning on technologies or using technology to make their coder teams more efficient. And we'll talk about that in just a few minutes. Next, Julia, please. So I think that without the use of extensive technology, it's really, really difficult to code correctly and to maximize your payments under Medicare Advantage. It's very important to code to that highest level of specificity and to not miss any codes. So it's important to not just simply carry over the codes year after year. You know, stuff that was documented last year needs to be reviewed to see if it applies this year and then needs to be documented. But you really have to dig deep into all the available patient information to look for codes that are easily missed. For example, if a patient is taking an antidepressant, but depression is not documented in the patient record, that's a missed opportunity. And sometimes it's getting to those little discrete pieces of information, such as a medication, a prescription, a lab result, that can make a significant difference on how much you're being paid or funded by the Medicare Advantage payers. So, you know, resources are really kind of thin right now. A few weeks ago, I talked to a former customer of ours. And back in the day, she was the coding director for a large health system. They had over 100 physicians, 7 or 8 facilities, a team of 20 coders, lots of resources. And they were really on top of their risk adjustment and HCC coding. She ended up switching jobs and she went to a small group with 15 physicians and 1 coder. So she went from lots of resources and technology to very little and stressed out physicians who had to do all of the coding themselves. So she ended up coming back to us because she said that she could not add more staff. So adding FTEs to the problem was not an option. So she wanted to revisit our technology, and we'll show it to you in just a minute, but she wanted to revisit that and put it into the hands of her one coder who can support a handful of physicians, but also get it into the hands of the physicians who need to do their HCC coding themselves. So fortunately for everybody involved, there have been lots of advances in NLP or natural language processing, which is a type of artificial intelligence. You've all heard of AI, but there's been many advances in NLP that have made this kind of technology affordable and available to groups of all sizes. It used to be that the bulk of the technology that you're going to see here in just a minute, it used to be really only for the payers. And let's face it, payers typically have deep pockets and everybody likes to sell to them. But this kind of technology was really only afforded by the payers. Well, companies like Inferscience come along and say, well, wait a minute, what about the providers? In fact, as a company, we were founded by a physician and he saw the need to provide technology to other docs to help them with HCC coding, validating codes and the like. So that's really what we're all about. But we work with groups of all sizes. We have customers who have one or two providers, and then we've got customers with hundreds. And in each and every case, everybody gets the same solution, same level of attention from us. Next, please. So this time I'm going to turn it over to my colleague, Matt, who's going to show you our HCC Assistant in action on the DrChrono platform. And I'll just say a few words about it at a high level, and then Matt will show you the specifics. So the HCC Assistant is about analyzing all of the patient data on the DrChrono platform. And we do that by analyzing all of the structured data in what's called the CCDA. And that's really just that chronological record of your patient's care. And it's got things like the problem list, SNOMED codes, RX norm codes, everything within that consolidated clinical care document. And then we also analyze all of the encounter notes that you enter into the system. So we call those all the free text or unstructured information. So we analyze all that and we dig deep into the record. And we not only identify the stuff that you have to carry over from year to year, but we also look at those discrete pieces of information, like I mentioned a few minutes ago. That's the stuff that can be hard to find. So we analyze that using our algorithms and our natural language processing to really return to you and to give you guidance on all possible HCC coding options. So that being said, I'm gonna shift it over to Matt for a few minutes and he's going to give you a live demo of the HCC Assistant on DrChrono.
Thank you, Derek. I really appreciate that. So just kind of jumping off from where we left off, the HCC Assistant is really driven to be a platform to really help physicians accomplish this piece of work, the task around identifying these codes, getting them documented into the patient's record, and even we can provide support in making sure the documentation is correct in real time. And we do this by being one of the first and only SaaS platforms out there to work with this. So this is where technology really starts to come into play to help with this piece of your workflow. And I'm going to shift screens for just a second. So bear with me just for a second while I change over to the actual DrChrono environment. So one of the key components of technology and making it really effective for any organization is putting it into a place where your work day is spent. And that's why we are grateful for the DrChrono people and their robust integration capabilities, because that allows us to bring our tool front and center to a work environment where you spend a great deal of your time. So with that, I'm going to walk you through just a general review of a patient's chart and how we can then leverage the HCC assistant to review that chart for potential addition of HCC codes. So I just went into the patient's section of DrChrono and reviewing this particular patient list. We're going to focus on this patient, Darcy Jones, and I'm going to click to open their patient record. So all of this should look very familiar to any user of DrChrono. Also, if you are a user of DrChrono and you have other apps that you are leveraging, you'll know where to find the Infera app. So if you do select a technology like ours to help support your work in HCC coding, it's certainly an easy add-on as an app into the directory for your workflow. So for this particular patient, you can look at all the information on any of the areas that you'd like to go into to review problems lists or medications, anything that you want to do. And as you're completing your charting efforts and you want to review this particular chart for HCC codes, then it's just a click of going into the Infera app. And once the Infera app loads, what it's going to bring up is a list of recent encounters or recent appointments or visits that have been documented in this particular patient's chart. So the HCC assistant is going to take whichever encounter you choose and is going to start an analysis on that chart using that last visit and reviewing the chart from there backwards into the history of that particular chart. So I've selected the one encounter that was documented and clicked continue. And in a matter of seconds, the analysis has been completed. And what as a provider you are presented with is a list of suggested ICD-10 codes that have been identified as HCCs. They're the hierarchical category condition codes that have been documented as chronic in nature. So these codes are now set for your review. And what you're looking at is a list of that, the actual code number, the description of the code, and what categories that it potentially fell into. The HCC assistant is also not just a kind of a black hole. We're not saying take our word for it that you need to add all of these codes. We also provide a great deal of background information on the codes. So if you click on the info box right next to the code number, we're going to give you additional information as to where we found this data sources. So for example, on this particular code, we found a data source in the problems list about type 1 diabetes. And we also found some information in the medications that have been diagnosed. And along with that, then we put that into a patient detail review to identify the yes, no, and actual pieces of documented values so that you can see how we have come up with the ability to say, we're going to take that information and create an analytical rule so that the technology can run. So now we've created a true or a false scenario of these different components, type 1 diabetes being true, this peripheral angiopathy being true, peripheral vascular disease being true, this particular medication being true, along with some of these brachial indexes on the ankle and the values, and then a false on potential of gangrene. So with that, that then produces the E10.51 code. And that saves you as a provider or your organization from having to do all the research within that chart to find where those particular pieces of information might have been located. So that information is right there at your fingertips. There's also a little drop-down arrow that gives some guidance about why the code was suggested. And then also we provide additional coding guidance. And that additional coding guidance can help you code to that highest level of specificity that Derek had mentioned a few minutes ago. Because all of these little add-ons are very important to how the payers are going to review the codes that have been submitted and the RAFs that are going to be applied. And certainly we're not coding for excess, but we're coding for what is actually present. And this is giving you that ability to identify that. And if that is something that you wanted to add on as a code, we have the feature down at the bottom of add code. It's a simple button that you can click on, and then you can complete whichever code. And we give you the guidance here, L97.5 or an L97.4, to type that in and add that into the chart, whether as a standalone code or even a companion code to this particular type 1 diabetes code. In addition to providing codes, one of the things about if you were to choose and select this E10.61 code for addition into your patient's chart, one of the things that you should do is offer a plan of care. If you're going to submit that, one of the things the payers are going to look for is, what is your plan of care? The Inferscience tool, the HCC Assistant, is going to provide a plan of care by default. If you like that potential plan of care, you can select that to be added into the chart. If you don't like that, if you have your own way that you're going to treat that particular patient, this field is fully editable. And you can add that yourself in. And if that is a standard way that you would treat this particular code for those patients, you can also then save it as a default here on the right, just next to that plan of care. And then each time this E10.621 would appear, regardless of patient, your defaulted treatment regimen for plan of care would be presented for you to be added into the chart. One of the key things here is the simplicity of our capabilities. The analysis ran in a few seconds. Your review is spent looking at the background information to support the code. And if you choose to add those in, there are simple clicks to add in the code and the plan of care information. And then once you have said, those are all the codes that I believe that need to be submitted or added for this particular patient's chart, it's one more simple click of submit to EMR. And that has now been successfully added into this patient's chart. So that's a very quick walkthrough of how the HCC Assistant works within the DrChrono environment. At this time, I'll turn it back over to Derek and let him continue with our conversation. And I'll also stop the sharing of my side so you can pick back up, Derek.
Hey, thanks, Matt. I was kind of busy answering some questions there. So I do appreciate everyone's questions. Please feel free to keep submitting them. And it looks like we'll probably have a few minutes to open it up if you'd like to ask us questions directly and have us discuss them during this webinar. But by all means, please feel free to keep submitting them either through the chat or the Q&A. So like Matt pointed out, the number one advantage of our Infera app and our workflow is that the coding guidance is delivered to the user when and where they need it. And that's typically right now or when I want it on demand and while you're working in the EHR. So like I said, most big data and analytics companies, they do a nice job of tackling this issue for the health plans, but not the providers. So we wanted to create a experience that was seamless to the EHR workflow. And DrChrono, honestly, for my money, I think it's probably the best integration that we have in terms of seamlessness and just ease of use. So hats off to Dr. Crono for a fantastic product, and they've configured it to work really well with our application. But the user experience is seamless. It's a time saver. Physicians and coders can spend significantly less time researching and searching for those HCC codes. And coders can review more charts in less time. It's going to make your coding more accurate because we will recommend things like companion codes or ways to code to a higher level of specificity, or even some of those easily missed codes, because we do make inferences and we don't simply look at what's in the problem list and say, go ahead and carry that over. We make inferences and we look for true prospective codes. Ultimately, you know, it's about optimizing your coding and increasing patient RAF scores. Next, please. So I do want to spend just a couple of minutes talking about outcomes. The question we get asked often is, well, what's the ROI? Or how many new codes can I expect you to find? Or what will it do to my patient's RAF scores? Now, the data for 2020 is just now starting to trickle in. So we're working with the providers who've been using the system for a number of years, and the ones who used it last year, perhaps for the first time. We're working with them to identify what increase in patient RAF scores can you attribute exclusively to using the Inferscience Infera app. Now, we lean heavily on our customers to provide that data simply because, well, we don't get their assigned RAF scores from CMS. So, you know, they need to work with us to make that data available. So the early returns for all the hard work that they put in for 2020, they're starting to trickle in. Now, we're seeing an average of about 0.2, 0.13 on the low end, and then we've got a customer who's up around 0.22 increase in RAF scores. But when we're talking about tenths of a RAF point, normally 0.2 of a point doesn't sound like much, but if you're talking about RAF scores, it can be substantial. So every single tenth of a point is significant. We even had a customer implement our solution for 350 providers because they estimated that they could increase their RAF scores by 0.05 of a point. So they made the investment just to capture 0.05 of a point. I'm happy to say they've exceeded that, but that tells you just how valuable these RAF scores are from a funding standpoint. Next, please. So if we wanted to return to our example of our 75 to 79 year old male, knowing that our customers are achieving about a 0.2 increase in RAF scores, that translates into about $2,000 a year in expected funding or expenditures. So it's a pretty substantial increase, and you can multiply that 2,000 by X number of Medicare Advantage patients, and you can kind of see how that can make an impact on your bottom line. So those are some of the returns that our customers are getting. Next, please. So we're at about 10 minutes before the hour, and there's our contact information. A few people had questions about how to get in touch with us. You can reach out to me directly. I will put you right in touch with Matt, who can provide you with a one-on-one demo and maybe do a deeper dive into the solution. I'm happy to join those calls and answer any questions that you might have. We just want to let you know that there is a technology solution out there for Dr. Crono that puts all of the advanced analytics that the big boys have kind of puts it into your hands. So with that said, I will be more than happy to spend a few minutes answering any questions. So Juliet, I don't know if you need to maybe unmute people, but feel free to ask directly or submit it through the chat or QA, and we'll stay to get your questions answered.
Perfect. Thank you guys. That was a great presentation. I learned a whole lot. There were a couple of questions that I saw pop in, so I will read them out loud here. A question that someone had here was, does plan of care go into plan itself? Oh, that was answered already. Thank you, Derek. Yes. So in that case, there was a question about the reporting capabilities with this integration. So if you guys can speak on that, if just how they can, you know, see the reporting for this product.
Sure. So we provide reports for the individual provider, and each provider can look at their HCC utilization metrics. So we report on things like how often was the app used? You know, that's utilization. What codes were suggested, and then what codes were ultimately documented in the DrChrono patient record. So we provide that at the provider or the individual level, at the coder level, if there are coders using it, but then also we roll it all up at the group level. So we can provide those overall metrics for the organization. So we provide high level metrics as well as very specific metrics at the encounter level. So we'll track every single code that was suggested, who touched it, who acted on it, and what was the outcome? Was it submitted? Was it rejected? Was it accepted into the record? So we provide all of that, very robust suite of reports. It would take us forever to go over them today, but for anyone who's interested, please email me or email Matt, and we'll be happy to get some sample reports and data sets into your hands so you can look at the numbers yourselves.
Awesome. And another question that came up is, how long does it take to actually get all of this up and running?
It's pretty quick. So really, once it's been authorized by DrChrono, then getting a user subscriptions created can be done usually same day for most of our DrChrono customers. It's very easy to get the subscriptions created, and the training is pretty simple also. You know, Matt went through the demo for you guys, but the training is very similar. It can usually be done in about 30 to 45 minutes. So if you decided, say, tomorrow that you wanted to use it, if you've got a few providers, you'd be up and running either same day or the next day. So it's pretty quick and easy. There was a question about how much does it cost. So we charge per user per month, just a flat user fee per month. And it's $150 to start. And then we've got ways to reduce that cost, things like paying in full every year. Or if you've got lots of providers, then we can work up a discount for you. But that's the ballpark right there.
All right, and Emma's question, sorry, Emma, I may have not understood you properly, I apologize. I wanted to clarify if copying over a previous note in that scenario, that it carries over as well as auto-populates into the note itself.
If copying over a previous note in that scenario, does it carry over, populate into the note itself? I'm not sure I quite understand. If we're talking about the plan of care information, does it populate into the DrChrono note itself?
Oh, and Emma, I'm going to allow you to speak. So Emma, if you can go ahead and try to explain.
Thank you so much.
You're welcome.
Yeah, I'm sorry for making it confusing. What I want, well, I wanted to know, number one, you know, when creating the HCC, does it auto-populate into the note itself when you're creating a note for a patient? A, and then B, let's say another time they come over, we usually carry the next note over and then update the subjective portion, for example. And in that case, does it also carry it over, or is there a specific way I have to like click to carry it over? It's the same process of, you know how when you're copying a previous note, it gives you kind of options, click and then click for the boxes. I think that's what I was trying to ask.
Yeah,
so I don't know if I'm asking it correctly.
Sure, thanks, Emma, for clarifying. I can speak to the codes themselves. So once you've selected and submitted the codes, they do populate the note. And then during subsequent visits, you don't have to manually carry those codes over. So, you know, you do it once with the codes themselves. Now, as far as copying over the other, you know, content pieces, you know, I think Dr. Crono could answer that piece, if I understand the question correctly. But the, for the codes themselves, they do carry over, and you don't have to re-document them every visit. They're already in the chart. I hope that helps, Emma.
Hello, Emma.
Oh, I'm sorry. Hello.
Yes.
Hello. Yeah. When you're on the note itself, whether it's a new patient versus a previous patient that you're copying a previous note over, but doesn't have the proper HCC codings in there, do I just go through the Infera app to add it, or will it be in the plan of care itself as a separate? On the top, you know how it says the ICD, and then next to it was like everything else, basically.
Sure. Yeah, if you input the plan of care and you document that with the Infera app along with the HCC code, then it will populate the plan of care.
Okay, so it will be included in the plan of care. I don't have to click on Infera to go through it, or I do.
Well, if you type in the plan of care in Infera, Infera will copy it over, but you could always put that in directly into Dr. Crono if you'd like.
I'm just trying to figure it out, especially for like established patients that are coming in for follow-ups, whether, you know, copying a previous note that didn't have the proper HCC coding, then in that case, it has to go through the Infera separately, right? Do I understand it correctly, kind of?
Well, Infera will help you with that initial documentation of the code and the plan of care. It will write it to the plan of care and to the patient record. But if you're copying over, you know, the clinical notes, that's not really an Infera process, but the codes will be there that you wrote, that you documented using Infera.
Okay, because what I noticed is if I log in from the computer versus the iPad, it looks very different. So that was why I wanted to kind of clarify that.
Sure, and you know, we'd be more than happy to hop on a one-on-one demo, and we could just walk through the process and live, and we could see what goes where. And maybe do a better job of answering your questions, since we'll have the app right in front of us. So if you're amenable to that, we're more than happy to get those questions answered for you that way.
Thank you. And may I ask, you said 150 to start and can reduce the cost in what ways? You said if multiple providers, but what would be like the minimum and what other way would
the cost? Sure, so two ways. Some customers want to pay for the year's subscription in full. So rather than 150 a month, they would pay, you know, 150 times 12. If that's the case, then we provide a 5% discount for anything that's paid in full for the year. And then for multiple providers, so anything, any groups that have over 10 or more providers, that's when we start to apply additional discounts. And it's usually, And so we take into account, you know, just how large the group is, before figuring out exactly what those discounts are, because the pricing, as much as we wanted to make it one size fits all, well, nothing's one size fits all. So we'll
of course. And what was
Sorry, Emma, hello, Emma.
I'm sorry, because you mentioned there are three ways, but I heard the two ways.
Oh, those are the two main ways.
Okay. And the over 10 providers is what percentage discount?
Usually it's going to be between 7.5% and 10% discount over 10 providers. Shoot us an email with kind of the specifics of your practice. We'll be happy to work up a quote for you.
Got it. Okay.
Perfect. And guys, we are out of time, and so I will have to stop the webinar. However, their contact information is available here on the screen. And so please reach out to them to schedule a time. Just to get just more information, you know, about your questions, because we definitely want to be sure that they are addressed. So thank you guys once again for showing up today. This was a great presentation, and we'll send this actual recording to you as well via email in about a couple of days. So you'll have this footage as well to show to anyone else or to just rewatch for yourself. So thank you, Derek and Matt, once again for a great presentation. Thank you all for joining, and you guys have a great rest of your day.
Thank you.
All right, thank you, everyone. Bye-bye.